And now, The Bonfire with Big J. Oakerson and Dan Soder.
Wow. Hey, everybody. It's The Bonfire. Comedy Central Radio, Sirius XM 95. I'm Big J. Oakerson. Dan Soder is off filming Billions today. I believe in today's scene, Paul Giamatti finally admits that he's been a clone the entire time.
Spoiler alert.
For the very last live show of the calendar year 2017, joining me, my dear friend, the hilarious, and let me say, his album, Live in Burlington, available on iTunes, and also you can catch him opening for the Impractical Jokers on the gigantic stage that is the Nassau Coliseum on New Year's Eve. Show favorite Mike Fenoia joins us.
Hey! Happy holidays, Jay.
Happy holidays, Bubba.
How you doing?
I'm doing pretty good. Yes, and I said this is the last live show. Tomorrow we are going to be airing at 6 p.m. our holiday show, the live holiday show we did at the Village Underground a few weeks back, and it was absolutely hilarious. Lou assures me, DJ Dead Rat himself says he edited this bitch down and it is ready to go.
It's an exceptional piece of work we did.
Say, though, that it was hard to edit because they didn't want to take anything out because it was so great.
That's actually true. It goes a little long. It's like 5 minutes or 10 minutes longer than a normal show. So you get extra for your buck.
Bonus.
Ooh, it's a little long in the tooth.
A little extra Christmas money in your basket.
And also, I have Christine being mad that people won't eat the pudding that we gave out.
That was fantastic.
Nobody's eating the pudding, and it's like devastating me that you guys aren't trying them.
Christine is easily devastated.
Yeah, and also there's sometimes, Christine, when you totally sound California.
Like, I heard it in there.
Devastating. Like, that's just so kind.
And like, it's like devastating, like me.
It's like eating my soul apart.
It's like my true self, guys.
Play it again. Was there a super California in that? Let me see if I catch.
Nobody's eating the pudding.
First of all, don't even go. She goes, hey, yo, everybody. I know we're out there enjoying some tasty waves, but in between, I kind of put out this pudding for you.
I got sand in my couch.
I know we're all catching our laugh waves, but in between, if you guys can suck down that pudding.
Delicious pudding.
I know some of you might have a dairy allergy, but
it's made with fresh avocado.
Nope.
One more, Lou.
Nobody's eating the pudding, and it's like devastating me that you guys aren't trying them.
Like, gather with a spoon.
Like, gather with a spoon, guys. The tasty waves are in my soul.
Totally.
Can we also lock
Barf
it down?
Out.
Guys, great news, by the way. Speaking of Get Me With a Spoon, I believe MTV 80s and 90s favorite John Norris is going to be covering for John Fugelsang tomorrow while he's doing TV.
Is that the word?
Just reading the notes here on the bottom of the screen. David Feldman, Judy Gold, and Jimmy Fallon all joining the show tomorrow. So
Whoa. Tune
in for a very special John Fugelsang.
How'd you get those notes? Did they leave something behind?
Oh, yeah. They left their notes in their screen there somewhere. Although I'm sure we've done that, too. Our notes are probably as much more fun than finding out John Norris is covering for you tomorrow. Ours are more like, I think cunt hole's the word you're looking for, says Black Lou. Yeah.
The annual percentage of butt lint in the past 10 years.
Yeah, we have much more fun shit going on in our notes. But we're not a political show. They are. What are you going to do? Speaking of politics, the politics of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, which people say is what's kept Moody Blues out for all these years. Turns out Moody Blues now going to be inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. I realized how I was very excited when I heard that and then realized only know three songs, only like two of them.
I don't even know.
I mean, this is a beast.
Right.
This one here, you want to cry? You want to fucking just be sad and bummed? You want to think about turning that wheel and just taking it off the goddamn impasse?
You just want to make love to a tree at 55 miles per hour?
You just want to give a fucking... You want to give a car smooch to a railing? Yeah, absolutely. For a few years, Bronx Tale took that away from me.
Yes.
The sadness of the song, and it just became like the racist fight scene.
Right, right.
But it's back.
Yeah.
It's back to sad.
I definitely, this would be in that catalog of songs that, like, if I have to listen to it, like, if I don't have a dial near me, say I'm in, like, a waiting room or whatever, I'll enjoy it. but I turn this off as fast as possible.
Because the bummer, or you don't think it's a good song?
It missed me. It didn't hit me in my heartstrings. It's a boring
Black
fucking...
Black Lou's nodding his head with you. Doesn't
crazy boring song, right?
Come on, wait right here.
Close it up. Sounds like a boring song.
Turn it up, Lou. The Angels?
Yeah.
And right here.
Their lovemaking must be beautiful.
Oh, God, fucking to this
that
song would be the worst.
Oh, this is not a fuck song,
no,
for sure.
Terrible fuck song.
No, this is a fucking sit in a dark room, stare at the ceiling.
Slow strokes.
Absolutely. Oh, this has been a good bum out song for me since, like, Boombox days.
Yeah.
Listen to it on a boombox.
But wait, it's not a fuck song? I thought Nights in White Satin means they're between the sheets.
Dude, this is a fucking bummer of a song.
That's about gay sex. Nights in White Satin.
No, this gets bummed. And then there's a fuck. And here's the thing. Just when you're at your saddest, you have to get up and turn off the CD at the time, because at the end of it, there's some weird fairy music that turns into a stupid poem.
Yeah, that's why I don't like it.
And he goes, breathe deep, the gathering gloom. Watch lights fade from every tomb. It's so weird.
Who is it? But Vincent this? Price? It's like Vincent Price does a talk down at the end of, if you're calling about the missing feet.
Darkness falls across the land.
It sucks.
A louder, Lou.
You guys want to hear a song? Freezing! Our rescue's head off pillow feed of concrete! Damn!
How long
did they... their moment.
Was this their first ballot?
No. I think they've been turned down several times. Find that out, Christine. What ballot is this for Moody Blues? I think they've just been knocked off several times.
I want to look up who isn't.
Lou keeps turning it down because he's starting to feel something.
Well, squelch those feelings,
right,
dude.
Lou, turn it up right here.
What's this
if
poem
this part, the poem's so far away, this right
the
here.
The poem is so far away.
This is the part where you slit your wrist in the tub. Look. Look at the buildup. High flute.
One last look in the mirror.
That's it. You bleed out. Boom. Clunk. Head hits the side.
You just stare at the toaster hitting the water.
Yeah, that's a hotel death. That's a hotel sad death.
The Moody Blues was eligible in 1989, but they've only had one nomination.
Well, the rule is, 25 years from your first album, I believe.
25 years from that.
And then 25 years thereafter.
Now, I know Stern's been a big advocate for them getting in for a long time. Always complained about them not getting. Man, they look dweeby.
What a bunch of... It's like the poor man's Procol Harum, right? Like, I'd like Whiter Shade of Pale is a better song in that sad fucking ilk.
No.
Come on, no?
Come on. This is so much more...
I don't like it.
Produced and great.
My band played that song, or my school band played that song, and I did a flag girl routine to it. So I always thought it was just like a band to Whiter Shade of Pale.
A flag girl routine?
Yeah, we had like white scarves we danced with on the football field.
Oh.
Oh, here
more like
the
flat girl routines,
flat girl
right?
Routine.
And that's the tit girls got on the cheerlead squad.
Oatmeal routine. Yeah, now it turns into this, like, the denouement of the song.
Oh, yeah, this is where it just takes a fat shit.
Yeah.
Totally. You hope when you put the song on repeat, so when your body gets discovered that this song is playing, you hope to God they don't walk in during this. Looks like a fucking fairy, like walking through the woods trying to wake the bears.
The detectives are like, hold on, the Holy Spirit is taking him now. Like,
yeah,
it's just
really
the sound
breathe
of like
deep,
ugh.
Gathering gloom.
Watch lights fade from every room.
Watch lights fade from every room.
It's awful.
Bedsitter people.
He goes, you've seen your life, your death, your death. It's just like the shitty poem.
It's like the first ever rap.
And then it really ends with like a Broadway flourish.
Can you imagine, like, imagine getting molested to this song? Like, you're laying in bed and this is on, and all of a sudden, like a scary man is in your room.
Lou, can you back up a couple seconds on that? Wait.
Breathe deep.
At one point, it's like the mother. Just listen to the word. It's pretty great. I mean, on a ridiculous level.
Bedsitter people look back and lament. Another day's useless energy spent.
For no mere mortal can resist.
Lovers wrestle as one. Lonely man cries for love and has none.
What a fucking...
New mother picks up and settles herself.
Yeah, they're clearly Rock and Roll Hall of Fame material.
Oh, no, they had a couple of... After this, I'll play a little dabs of the other ones that are pretty good.
Yeah, let's hear the other two biggies.
Colors from our side.
I'll give you the other two biggies.
Let me they could do this poem live.
Oh, God.
Dude, a Moody
Blues head? Wait. Listen to Flourish.
and which is an illusion.
It's Phantom of the Opera now.
It's so...
I'm still gonna send it.
Send it!
Just gonna send it!
Man, what a shit that great song takes. Tuesday afternoon, you have that there, Lou? Yeah.
So, if you go see Moody Blues in concert, I mean, is this ever played?
I don't think Moody Blues done a concert in fucking decades.
Well, I'm saying, even back the week that this fucking album came out.
Like, did they do that poem?
Yeah.
Oh, abso-fucking-lutely.
People just lose it. People are, I know this one.
Yeah, this is
I don't like this band.
I thought you just said I know this one.
I know it, doesn't mean I like it.
I thought you liked it.
This is too.
Lou, you like this.
I don't recognize it yet.
Oh, you'll know it.
Afternoon.
I'm just beginning to see.
I'm
on my way.
Like that mod voice. Plug your nose, man. Just sing it, plug nose.
Chase the clouds away.
And then the other one would be... Fuck, why am I drawing a blank now?
It very much reminds me of...
Wildest Dreams. Isn't that Moody Blues?
I'd like to see a listen.
Wildest Dreams. They have so many songs.
In Your Wildest Dreams?
In Your Wild... Your. Yep. Your Wildest Dreams.
I mean, this.
Oh, what is it with their fucking turn the page fucking...
Well...
This sounds like a little kid's
fucking
book.
Cliff bought an electric harp, and they're like, we gotta use this fucking thing.
Why'd he buy a clavichord? Everyone's like, dude, I bought us clean needles. He's like, I bought an auto harp. Fuck the Moody Blues.
Wow. When's it get to it?
I mean, honestly, what is this pixie garbage?
Fucking Ralph brought the wind chimes. Just let him play the goddamn wind chimes. But this gets 80s. This is the Touch of Grey for the dead.
For the Moody Blues, yeah.
This was definitely like a radio hit.
It's like one guy on a keyboard at 4 a.m. Oh yeah. What a fucking what a doofus band. Black Lou, this band sucks, right?
Who would you compare them to today? Because I'm learning right now.
Oh,
but who would
today?
You compare them to, like,
today?
Group wise today? Yeah.
Shit.
Are they a joke? Are they
no,
seriously?
No, they're not a joke. They're just like they're so like prog.
Yeah.
That it's like, I don't know who to compare it to. I wouldn't listen to whoever they are now.
Yeah, no, totally. I don't think it would
Logic.
I don't know
anything about Logic.
Well, I'd say maybe 60s, like, early 70s is when they started, so.
Dude, it was a lot
compare
of, like.
It to anything now.
I don't know. I don't think that. Do you mean, like, in the sense of, like, are they, like, as popular as a Radiohead now? Or is that what you mean?
Exactly.
Like, popularity?
Oh,
you're like,
fucking
like
absolutely.
Owl City or something like
there
that?
There you go. Not quite as popular, but yes. But Radiohead.
Yeah.
Compare them to. They're like Radiohead of the 60s, for sure. They wanted to use a lot more, like, electronical stuff and or big orchestra. You know, it's like every song's got to be very big and full.
Yeah, everything has to sound like a fairy taking a piss. I fucking hate the
piss fairies.
I can't stand them.
All you found out here is that you hate the Moody Blues? All the originals, you can tell in this picture had mustaches.
I'm excited to see the speech, because you know how they always grab, like, a big fan?
Thank you, lovely
and it's, like,
one.
The person who, like the guy who, like, the Moody Blues changed his life. You know what I mean? They always have that guy who's like...
They know all their names. Carl! Richard! Thomas! Steven!
And you know, we all have to tip a hat for Dennis. We lost Dennis. Thoughts and prayers to our first...
Five class.
Our first clavichord player.
He goes, Moody Blues, bathroom break. I'm going to watch. I want to go to this concert in the worst way. I think it's going to be a great... You went last year, Lou, right?
Yeah, but it was in New York.
Was it awesome? Isn't it always in New York?
No.
No, it's in Cleveland this year.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I'm out.
Really?
I'm out.
I would make that. Well, there's nobody I really love. Who else we got?
Oh, dude. So after this, I'm going backwards. Let's talk about the... Should we talk about the ones that I'm super psyched about? What order should we go here? Because there's two I don't know a goddamn thing about.
And there's a couple I'm pretty...
Order of enthusiasm.
Oh, hang on. Heather Esquire from Twitter says that they play that song. Heather, you there?
Hey, guys. What's up?
Hey, Heather. What's up? You're on the Bonfire with me and Mike Fenoya.
Are you
last live show of the year. You took your mother to see the Moody Blues?
Yes, I did.
So,
and
of course.
They absolutely play that horrible song.
Whoa, which horrible? Knights in White Satin?
Yes, yes.
What happened? Who hurt you to that song, Heather?
How many people shot themselves in the crowd?
Well, you know, it's all old people, so they're digging it, man. They're loving it.
Yeah, did you start beating up the black brother of the girl you liked? That was the scene from Bronx Tale.
Just chair dancing? I bet there was a lot of chair dancing at the concert. Like sit dancing.
Oh, yeah. A lot of old lady swaying.
Was there a lot of jazzy routines happening? As in all the people in their motorized carts watching the Moody Blues?
Just bumping into each other?
Actual jazzy.
Sing.
They do the song. They do the whole, like the little twinkles and the poem flourish. Oh, yeah.
Yes, with a lovely light show in the background.
Oh, I can imagine.
Put you right to sleep.
I look at Mike.
Put you right to sleep.
Look at Finoy being all high and mighty. You literally just described a fish concert. A bunch of people chair dancing, broken hips on the floor.
Fuck that, dude. We're standing up.
But a dope-ass light show.
Dope-ass light show. Fifth member of the band.
Did you not enjoy the concert at all? Your mom was a fan?
Yeah, I took her for her birthday one year. You know, I think like you, there's a couple songs. It's like, all right, you know, I can dig it. But, you know, for the most part, like I said, just...
But Heather, are you saying the song Knights in White Satin, the first two-thirds of it, isn't a song you want to kill yourself in a bathtub to? I don't know how to describe why I like
it. Yeah, honestly. It's like you're coming down off Percocets when
that's a bummer. It's a bummer, too.
Yeah, exactly. The crescendo, you know, it's like, it's so depressing. Yeah, I don't want to hear it.
Like, nobody left there with, let's fuck energy, I feel, that night.
Did they have an orchestra?
Again, with the old people, not so much.
Did they have an actual orchestra playing the classical parts, or was it, like, one nerd on a keyboard?
Yeah, you know what? I do not remember. I was not paying that much attention.
I'm sure it's a track. They probably play to a track most.
Yeah, because, who the fuck? Imagine, being a roadie at MSG, Jesus Christ, the Moody Blues are coming in. We got 68-piece
only four of these guys.
Triangle solo. They suck.
Thanks for the call, Heather. I'm sorry that happened to you.
It's all good. Happy New Year, guys.
Crackle, happy New Year and happy holidays, sweetie. Crackle, crackle.
Well, first off,
Sister Rosetta Tharpe is one of the two of whose music I'm not familiar with here at all, of the six inductees. Sister Rosetta Tharpe, anything, Mike, on that? Have you ever heard of her?
I feel like she's...
It looks like banjo black people music.
Yeah, I kind of feel... I've heard of her... Yeah. Won't you hear me? And documentaries about the history of music in America that came from you know, Lead Belly all the way up. She's like a female, she was the...
Is she still alive?
No.
Christine.
This is from 1930.
Sister Rosetta Tharpe. I mean, you're assuming so, because they couldn't figure out photography without massive shadows in her picture.
Yeah. Right? It's the Prohibition headshot era.
Oh, yeah, she died in 1973.
Holy shit.
1973.
Lord, taketh away Sister Rosetta Tharpe. You done fucked up now. I can't wait to see who's going to come. Who's going to come take a thing in her place and go, Rosetta was a fine woman. She never got to know the pleasure of a man. Never got to see her grandbabies rise up.
Born a lonely woman, died a lonely woman.
Growing up on the bayou, Sister Rosetta Tharpe, she tried harder than a motherfucker.
Oh, yeah. I like this shit.
What are you, Quentin Tarantino?
Yeah. I've been listening to too much Jack White.
Yeah. And then I was like, oh, you know, I'm going to make a Quentin Tarantino movie. I need some obscure old black folklore.
Someone that, tied strings to a box. It's like an empty Clementine's container.
Yeah.
We couldn't afford guitars or to make our own.
I used all the music from Hambone Watkins' debut album from 1925. It was actually illegal that a colored man record in a studio.
All right, so sister,
hey, your producer is back there. Went back there with that young girl. Who seems to be screaming right now. He goes, "That's not my issue right now. We're talking about movies, film, action, ninjas, women heroes. I'll make women heroes to make up for all that nonsense.
Shoot 50 men to make a woman a hero."
Uma Thurman's like, yeah, Harvey just shot jizz in my face without asking me. And he's like, you want to be the star of this new movie?
Mm-hmm. You're in, baby. Blow some coke and listen to Lead Belly.
Although, in fairness to Harvey Weinstein, if you end up shooting jizz at Uma Thurman's face, odds are you going to hit her eyes. Her face is almost 100% eyes.
Yeah, and it's the color of jizz.
They go from her ears to her nostrils.
It's just moisturizer for her.
Nina Simone.
Yeah.
I know the name very much. Not familiar with the music. I'm sure there's songs I know.
Yeah, just a great voice.
What's the big hit? Oh, from Porgy
and
Bess.
Well, Feeling Good, which is the Michael Bublé covered.
There we go. Oh.
You know.
Oh, I thought that was a Michael Bublé hit. I don't know that one.
I also...
what the fuck? You know Michael Bublé's the one of the tracks of his third album? You know what I'm talking about.
Thanks, Hoda.
Very masculine voice.
Like, you... Yeah, beautiful voice.
She has the masculine in her voice that Wayne Newton had the feminine.
Yeah.
Everybody gonna be alright.
This is the song you know?
It's a new life for me. I love this song.
Me too.
You do, Lou?
Sure do.
You love Nina Simone?
No, just the song.
Oh, what is this the song? It's been a long, long time coming. And I know long gonna get me home.
Gonna be all right.
You'll know it here.
Everybody in this goddamn place gonna be all right.
Everybody get your ass together for the picnic. We gonna have a picnic.
Bring all that potato salad down to my picnic, baby.
Damn, damn, damn.
God bless her. Good voice. She looks like a racist drawing.
She really does. She totally does. Like if you had to draw a black person on your own thumb.
It looks like the black version of the turtle you have to draw to prove you can draw to get drawing lessons from that online
thing. Oh my God, that's hilarious.
I did that thing. I sent that thing in.
Did you do that?
Yeah,
like
I
a
did.
Turtle wearing a hat?
They said I won first place.
Yeah.
To nothing.
Everybody won first place.
Yeah. They sent you a painter's hat with a...
You're an artist. Go get them.
Is I Put a Spell on You originally?
Oh, yeah.
I imagine.
Let's hear it.
Because who covered that famously?
Marilyn Manson.
Well, no, that's not the famous. I mean, no, but it's a...
Oh, I Put a Spell on You.
Yeah. Moody Blues?
Oh, yeah.
Click her version of I Put a Spell on You.
It's a race. Who's going to get it?
And go. Oh, yeah. This is like Sam.
Maybe this is the version we know. This was after she smoked.
Yeah, this is
Camel Unfiltered for 10 years.
This was actually a radio commercial for Pall Mall.
I put a smell on you.
Oh, this might be the version I do know.
Oh, this is so like shadowy detective movie.
Yeah.
Throwing your overcoat over the fucking, like, dirty desk.
It's very film noir.
Yeah, going through your desk, pulling out, like, a drip of whiskey.
Getting paid to chase around these deadbeat dads and philandering husbands.
The streets were
life.
The streets were hot, but Darlene was hotter.
Have you seen this girl?
In the distance, you could hear the train rolling down the tracks.
Have you seen this girl? Have you seen this man?
I scratched my butt and then smelled it. I had a shitty asshole.
As I approached the corner, I thought to myself, I got a shit. I hope the Starbucks has a private bathroom.
Modern day Sam Spade.
I got a shit. Thank God I joined New York Sports Club, so there's a place I can shit every couple blocks.
I was sitting there realizing I really should delete social media from my phone.
Spend too much time.
All right, Nina Simone. I'm pro her for the induct.
Yeah.
She's great.
Yeah, no, I'm okay with that, too.
One of our favorite bands is finally...
Is Screamin' Jay Hawkins the original one, maybe? Play that one. Everybody gonna be all right? Yeah, Screamin' Jay Hawkins sounds like it's gonna be some serious, like, voodoo black shit.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, this man, look at that. That's a scary picture.
Hell yes.
If that picture was in my hotel, I would leave the hotel.
It looks like a doll came to life.
Kill the man. Yeah, this is the original,
hey,
right?
Whitey. You having yourself a good sleep, Whitey?
What's up, cream of wheat?
Hey, mayo.
What's up, tartar sauce face?
Wait a second. Go to the video of him doing that. Is that a video of him down there? It looks like he's black. It looks like he's wearing blackface.
Live at Budokan? Oh, wow. This is old. Oh, shit.
One, two. This will all be up at the Bonfire.
Yeah.
He's got a bone through his nose. This
wow
is this would shut down a fucking powerhouse network today.
This really would.
Holy shit.
He's dressed like Papa Shango.
Joe Boo.
This is my wife's head on this stick.
Because of mine.
Holy Holy Christ.
Guy was a performer.
That's not a bone. That's just Coke shaped like a bone. Look at his eyes.
They said he was James Brown before James Brown.
Lames Brown.
It says 1956 original was Jay Hawkins.
Can I please use your water fountain? I'm awfully thirsty from singing.
Dude, if he got on the bus dressed like that, he would have sat wherever he wanted.
Shows would be nice to vote.
I really don't like getting sprayed with a fire hydrant.
I'm tired of pig feet. I want pig butt. I'm tired of pig feet.
Pig feet's old and boring. Stop pickling on the meat.
Damn.
Yeah, what a voice.
Is he in the Hall of Fame?
Yes.
Thank God.
Oh, what are you going to say, no? He comes up on the ballot, you're like, I'm voting for fucking Scream Day Hawkins.
I'm scared of that fucking...
I don't want to curse.
I don't want that voodoo spirit haunting me at night.
This is also one of... There's a list in its Rock and Roll Hall of Fame's 500 songs that shaped rock and roll, and this song's one of them.
Oh, yeah. Everyone's scared of him.
Yeah, no one's going to say anything that this isn't a boring one-note song.
Yeah,
Everyone's like, no, dude, you're a genius, dude. You're a genius. Please don't hurt anyone.
He bullied his way into history.
Oh, I'm going to put a spell on this whole motherfucking building.
Shakaka, Shantulu, Shreelma.
He's sitting in a management meeting and they're like, we're going to renew your contract. He turns around, he's got the bone in his nose. Like, no, wait, did I say no? I mean, 5 years, 20 million.
He sprinkles the Beetlejuice dust on the guy's head.
He's
terrifying. Screaming Jay Hawkins?
Yeah, what's the after party hang with Screaming Jay Hawkins like?
After the party is the hotel lobby. Yeah, he's terrible. Is this more Screaming Jay Hawkins?
That's screaming.
Legend has it that's the sounds of him fucking the producer's white wife.
This is him taking a gumbo shit in the middle of July.
I feel like this crawfish still alive.
Pinch of my butt.
They crawling out.
Wow.
Take the jaws and the paws off a
cliff. Screaming Jay Hawkins, solo album, Gather Around the Cauldron.
Oh, man.
That's not what it's called.
I wish it was.
What a crazy, he's from Cleveland. Look at that.
He has some wildly theatrical performances. It reminds me of Gloria Brinks from In This Moment, like what she does now. It seems like same type of influence.
She's the new Screaming Jay Hawkins. Maria Brink from Little Known In This Moment.
I like that era of music when it was like Screaming Jay Hawkins, like Flash and Don McGillicuddy. It's like Jumping Jimmy Dagaloo.
Steaming Pete Jameson.
Steaming Pete. Thundering Rodney Johnson on the tub. And then let me introduce you to my band. Back yesterday. On the drum.
Boom, dip.
Shattering Willie Nixon. Yeah.
We call him Skins. It's Billy Haunches McDougal.
Let me introduce you on the saxophone. Rodney, the one leg. Rodney!
It's Billy Outer Reeds Jones. Let's take our first break. And we'll come right back and go through the rest of these inductees. If you're listening live, it's the last one of the new year. We're hanging out with Mike Fenoya.
Call and say hi.
It's the Bonfire. Woo!
And now, back to the Bonfire with Big J. Okerson and Dan Soder.
I built everything. Every square inch from crown molding to chair rail to floors to lighting to plumbing, doors, windows. So this is the type of guy you get. That's handy guy.
I don't know what happened there.
That's actually hilarious.
Can we?
I meant to go bowling.
Ground molding. Is that it for Runaway?
Well, now it is.
It's just a wrap?
Wow.
I mean, do you want to know how it ends?
The Runaway
was so abrupt.
The Runaway got hit by a fucking utility truck.
I was going to jump in on some of those whales. He does those screamy whales at the end. I thought we were all going to do that as a family. Hey. Very anticlimactic. Let it play. It's a Bonfire. Comedy Central Radio, Sirius, XM 95. Big J. Okerson, Dan Soder. Not here today, but you can catch him at Albany Funny Bone Thursday, December 28th through Saturday, December 30th. Then at the San Francisco Punchline, Thursday, January 4th through Saturday, January 6th. Get tickets for that and all Dan shows at DanSoder.com. Mike Fenoya joining us. His album, Live from Burlington, available on iTunes. He's also going to be opening for the Impractical Jokers at the Nassau Coliseum in Long Island. That is an awesome thing.
And Jay Oakerson.
New Year's Eve, that is.
And Jay will be at the Hartford Funny Bone in Manchester, Connecticut, Thursday, January 4th through Saturday, January 6th. Get tickets at BigJComedy.com. And I might be there with you.
Woo! Woo, much a little runaway. Wow. Bon Jovi.
I got
Steve Reich.
I got drywall screws. I got bucket of spackle.
I do my own crown molding. I do this. I got the chair rails, the whole thing. Dimmer switch.
I got a guy to get my tiles fucking cheap. I thought we were actually listening to Bon Jovi fans.
Terracotti. Yeah, that really. By the way, that's not the first time a conversation's happened. So the first time Runaway's been interrupted for a conversation about construction parks.
It makes you feel like a woman, a real woman.
Feel good.
Believe
some Bon Jovi.
Have you experienced
vinyl siding?
You want to know who your ex-boyfriend is?
Fun fact: I went to CCD with JBJ. That's what we used to call him, JBJ. John Bon Jovi.
Mrs. Czeslkowski was our teacher.
John Bon Jovi. Yeah. That weird Italian name.
John Bon Jovi. Yeah. Good thing he changed it.
The Jove.
He redid the spelling. They were my most favorite band growing up. I would jump up and down.
Me too.
Yarn a tennis racket.
Yeah.
I made a strap out of yarn, and I would jump up and down on my bed to Slippery
When Wet. I'm happy that you clarified you made the strap out of yarn. So when you said yarn a tennis racket, I thought you meant you put six pieces of yarn down to make strings on a tennis racket. I'm like, too much.
What do you think, I Suggy Mae Johnson the tennis racket? Suggy Mae.
It's flipping Charles Watkinson. On keyboards, Bon Jovi. Whoa, they really got a good picture of Bon Jovi's hair, Flippy.
Oh yeah, look at that.
Well, that was my poster. That was the poster that was behind my...
Yeah, that was in Teen Beat.
Wait, go down, Christine. Go down on the screen a little bit. That's the one. It's the one with the jacket. He's not giving me double gun barrels at all. Yeah, I think it was that one. No, I think he was wearing a duster in the one I had. I don't know. Either way, I had a fucking full door-sized poster of John Bon Jovi, not realizing that the posters were meant to be sexy for girls.
Yours was the... Well, I had one, too, and I wasn't playing with my clit to it, so...
Was he wearing knee-high boots in that? Yeah, dude, I thought he was the shit.
It was amazing. He was the best.
That album, when Slippery When Wet came out, and they were the highest number, right? They got, like, first place in the voting.
Yeah. I wonder if they're a first ballot inductee.
Yes, yeah. Absolutely. I mean, I'm 100%. No. Come on, really? They missed it before?
Yeah, Bon Jovi, they've been eligible for years. They just got in this year.
Being eligible, yes, but there are bands that are nominated and they don't make it, is what I mean. So I didn't know if they were like a first-time nominated.
I mean,
they were passed over for a bunch of years.
Did not have a hit, at least, or some sort of radio-friendly hit on every album they've ever put out.
Yep.
Even the songs I don't like, because I was out of them by that point, I know It's My Life. I know that song.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, the lyric, like, Frankie said I did things my way, makes me want to punch, like, just break a car window. It makes me so... What a shitty, shitty line.
Yeah, it really is. They didn't stray too far from their bullshit start.
Yeah, they went away. But, I mean, like... When they were music for my age that I was, damn, they were great.
Raise Your Hands was one of my favorite songs. That was like one of the first songs. I think that might have been, it was not one of their biggest hits, but what a great song. And I love them so much. My Uncle Mike and Aunt Nancy brought me to New Haven Coliseum, the now defunct New Haven Coliseum. This is Raise Your Hands.
Oh, yeah.
Such a fucking kick-ass song.
You got a nasty reputation.
All the bald white guy just came out of Mike right there all in one shot.
This is long hair, Mike.
Oh, little kid Mike jumping up and down on his He-Man thing.
Were you swaying the head back and forth?
Oh, I fell off the bed hard.
Yeah. You're like, if I could, you have first audition to be in Rat, and then I'll meet the Bon Jovi guys, and then they'll say, fuck Richie Sambora.
You.
I want this bald kid with a tennis racket.
Bald kid with a tennis racket.
Still, it's just you now. Why does a 7-year-old have a hairy back?
Let's go full throttle.
I'm 7 years old, I'm bald, and I got a hairier chest than Bon Jovi.
Oh, this guy, I'll tell you what, I know he's seven, but this kid's great for the group. I mean, He makes us all look great with the picture. We all look right in the picture together.
You're out on the run. I'm in a gun. Gonna set the night on fire.
Wow. Man, the lyrics are 80s lame, huh?
Yeah.
I'll be there for you. That's my Bon Jovi. That's when I used to have my my G.I. Joe's fight over a girl to that song.
No shit.
Yeah.
What girl? Oh, you had the G.I. Joe girl.
Yeah, I think it was the girl Ninja, Jinx, or it might have just been a straight-up Scarlet.
Or maybe a My Little Pony that you pretended to be.
No, I didn't have dolls, Mike. I had action figurines.
You had your guys fight over a... over a chick to yeah. be there for you?
She'd be at a party with some other G.I. Joes. And then Road Pig, the big, muscular, yeah. flat-top dreadnought.
Sure.
With his anarchy tattoo.
Uh-huh.
And a fucking baseball bat with a cinder block on the end of it came to get his fucking bitch.
He showed up at the G.I. Joe Christmas party.
But he leaves without her. It's why he leaves.
Does he do a look back?
Yeah, he kicks everyone's ass and then realizes that she doesn't want to go with him. And then he leaves very sad. These were very elaborate.
Oh, no. I'm with you.
Daydreams.
Did you used to use your bed as the landscape?
Yeah, but not like in any case. It was just where I was playing.
No, I just didn't know
toys.
If you'd ever, like, because sometimes I would, like ruffle up the covers to almost make, like, hills
oh,
to walk
sure.
away on.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Oh, some steps?
Yeah, to add yeah. dramatic effect.
Yeah, I don't have them go reflect by where I pissed in my bed, my piss stain.
A frozen pond, a.k.a. jizz load. An ice skate on an old load.
By the time I was loading, I forgot about having fake
yeah.
G.I. Joe parties.
You sell those things for fucking penthouse
yeah,
forum.
I got all. I get rid of all of them for one, the only action figure I ever needed the rest of my life.
Remember starting lineups? Do you remember those toys? Like the football player?
I have one. I have a Randall Cunningham.
So the helmet of a starting lineup
came off.
Fits exactly perfectly on a G.I. Joe guy's head.
Big deal. That's
so
a real big deal.
What I had a Huddles bedspread, right? Remember Huddles, the little G.I. Mm-hmm. the little football guys? So I would always have an all-star game on my bed. And I took Warren Moon and I cut the ball out of his hand. And that's where we would have, like, all-star games was on my bed. And then
you'd have to do that, actually, because they made a guy named Gridiron in G.I. Joe at one point who had fucking little football grenades that clipped into the hands.
Oh, no shit?
It was.
I didn't have him.
Gridiron, his name is. G.I. Joe Gridiron.
I used to love when, like, we'd have to call, like, an injury timeout when,
yeah,
like,
I played
the hips
a lot.
Would fall off.
Their dicks just snapped. I was real big on playing football games, but that was good mood times. When I was, the dramatic stories were the different ones. Yeah, you see, he's got football grenades.
Oh, man, that's so cool. Yeah, so after the game, your players have CTE. They've retired. Now they're at the holiday party, and Bon Jovi's playing.
Unfortunately, his football helmet sucked, though. It was an army helmet with a football mask on it, so that blew. So everyone played without helmets, but we definitely had a football.
Jovi and Skid Row, what an incredible concert. I was 8 years old. It was 1987. And all I remember is just, like, aqua-netted up hair, cigarettes and joints.
The
burning.
Song came on, you made out with your mom.
I made out with Aunt Nancy for, she gave me her, she made a mouth out of her hand and I just Frenched it.
I understand.
Ciao, baby.
No, you let that song play.
Did you ever see them live in the old days?
Never saw them.
They had a
bums me out.
He had like a very elaborate kind of like walkway out, sure. And they would lift it up over the crowd and kind of like do a. In retrospect, it wasn't all that amazing, but it was pretty neat to like.
No, that's and you're talking about like ruffled denim jacket.
Yeah,
long hair. Awesome Bon Jovi.
Super. I mean, 87.
Yeah,
amazing. And I remember people booing.
Wow! Yeah! We did it! We beat SiriusXM!
We got drywall, tape and compound, flathead screws, 90-degree arc.
Some new light fixtures, a nice runner for the hallway.
We put a couple cans up here.
I built everything.
Everything you got, yeah, I built.
I'm molding the chair rail,
Christine,
the lighting.
I saw a recent picture of Sambora. Holy fucking shit, he looks like a candle.
Looks like a cigar store Indian.
He looks like a fucking wax idiot.
He's waxwork.
He looks like
an evil person made him a figurine.
I think he was on another show here, and they took a picture, and it was fucking scary.
He's on Jim and Sam.
Are they going to play together, you think?
Yeah, Jim and Sam. No, they're...
They said they are. Well, they're open to playing again with Richie, but it's not the same without Richie.
And he said no?
I don't know. It's all.
Why do they get so mad, these fucking old ladies? I mean, come on,
that
you
really
bunch of
is kind of crazy.
What are you doing?
Like, Richie wrote half the songs, and he sings backup, but he's the greatest guitarist.
Yeah, it's not
so sad.
I don't know. Is he the greatest?
Correction. If the greatest one the band could have.
Yes.
Nobody's going to do better than him.
Well, I mean, he's the guy. And the voice. His background vocals were the shit.
Yeah, very important, yeah.
Yeah, they really are a Hall & Oates.
He's this guy. Wanted. That's
wanted,
him.
Wanted. And I ride.
I'm wanted.
With his,
he's like, Richie, stop trying so hard, motherfucker. We're doing this acoustic.
It's my band. It's my last name. Shut up.
Those backup dipshits can't do it justice.
Oh, hey, I didn't realize your name was Richie Bon Jovi. Oh, it's not? Then back the
Dude,
fuck
shut
down.
Up!
Then back the fuck down.
Don't make me get Alex Von Suck and Tico Torres after you. What a bunch of shitty names.
Oh, Tico Torres? Yeah, Alex, what is it?
Von Such. Or Suck?
No.
Yes, it is.
Alec John Such?
Yeah, Alec John Such.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. I got the Von and the John.
Oh, I mean, that's way different. You mean it's like he's a fucking barren pilot. Alex Von Suchkins.
Yeah, they deserve it. I'm pro Jovi getting in.
Absolutely
sure.
Deserve it. I haven't listened to Bon Jovi with any kind of real, actual desire to listen to it for years. But they had a time in my life. And a good 6-year run,
mm-hmm.
The most important band to me.
It almost went.
I mean, I should say, how long did it take? They put those albums out quick. I got Slippery When Wet. I went back to Bon Jovi self-titled and 7800 degrees or 7800 degrees Fahrenheit,
yep.
It's called. And then
New Jersey.
Slippery When Wet. And then New Jersey came out. All great. And then I think right after New Jersey was when I just started going to adult contemporary.
Yeah, Wanted Dead or Alive was basically kind of it for me. And then that's when they got into, like, tanning booth music.
Oh, you like New Jersey, you said?
New Jersey was,
No, One of Their Lives, the first one.
Blaze of Glory.
That's solo.
Blaze of Glory is what I'm talking about.
I like solo, though. Blaze of Glory.
Yeah, so good. But I think I was growing out of it at that time, too. I think it was, like, hip-hop was starting to become a fun thing, and...
What about this? You recognize this ditty?
This one right now?
Yeah.
Of course.
Oh, okay.
It's, I got nothing in you.
Bed of Roses?
Yeah. For the night I sleep for the bit. Get to that part, Lou. I'm going to nail it. I'm in a singing mood today. It's the end.
Yeah, let's harmonize our way out of this fucking terrible year.
Let's do it. Here we go.
I bet y'all find it.
Oh, you'll find
I got drywall.
You don't know how beautiful you are.
Woodworkings. Hard. I made this chair. This fence all me.
This is golden oak stain.
Yeah. I hired a couple of shines to throw the actual locks on, but you know.
Lighting to plumbing.
Roofing.
Doors, windows.
Move. The copper thing. I plugged on all holes with Brillo.
We need some quickcrete.
Every square inch from crown molding to
this
chair.
This is literally the conversation that happens over most Jovi. It's fucking amazing.
Most Jovi.
Most Jovi is spoken about with like a Dunkin' Donuts cup in your hand with like just numbers written on it. Like a square pencil that you actually sharpen with a razor. Like a contractor razor. It's fucking great.
Let's I'm going to go snap throttle. A chalk line and listen to some Jovi.
That's great.
Let's take our second break.
Fall in love with you.
We have to take breaks before 7. It's a big deal. I don't care where Jacob's on tour right now.
Somewhere he's looking up.
They're not taking a break yet.
I bet the 6:55, these fuckers ain't taking a break. They're knee deep in a Jovi right now. I've seen this happen. You're getting to a Jovi, a J-hole.
J-hole. He's 60% in a Marlin right now.
He's hanging out.
Got a break. Got a break. The son of a bitch got me. Oh, God. He's swallowing me down. He's digesting my feet.
We'll be right back. We're hanging out. Mike Fenoya.
Whoa.
It's the Bonfire.
And now, back to the Bonfire with Big J. Oakerson and Dan Soder.
Dire Straits, everybody. It's Bonfire. Comedy Central Radio, Sirius XM 95. Big J. Oakerson, Dan Soder out doing his billions thing. You'll see him again in the new year. Right now, we have show favorite Mike Fenoy joining us. Dire Straits, huh?
I was telling Lou during the break that, like, basically this is us on the road. So we just literally, like, play music, sing, and harmonize as loud as we possibly could. Oh, yeah. And, like, just talk about how... it's a, that's what's so fucking fun about it. The show is the show is the bummer.
Yeah.
The show ruins the hang.
It can ruin the hang sometimes. Even Black... You know what bands the shit when Black lose nod in his head to some Dire Straits?
Are you privy?
I've never heard that before, so I'm learning a lot today. Oh. That shit was amazing.
Dude, welcome Dire to Straits. A very enjoyable wormhole that you're about to get into.
Yeah, Dire Straits will get you going. Their lead singer is also the lead guitarist. That's a rare thing. So you watch video of them. Go to, like, the middle, Christine, of, like, their big famous concert footage. Go to the middle when he's, like, doing... Sultan's a Swing.
Sultan, yeah.
And you watch a guy who could play guitar that intricately and sing.
Black
he was
Blue.
Never good-looking, ugly guy. Ugly as all hell.
Crazy ugly. But I imagine if you heard Sultan's a Swing, you might have already heard it in
yeah,
your
probably.
Life. It's
okay.
A pretty...
Well, no, you know, he's definitely heard... Well, you've definitely heard, like, money is for nothing and the chicks for free.
I believe so.
Yeah, I mean...
No, that was a no.
No, if you play it, he'll probably know
probably
it. And you probably know Romeo and Juliet, too. I'd say those are the two most mainstream.
Romeo and Juliet.
That's pretty obscure.
He's not
going to
know that one.
A 29-year-old black kid. The Walk of Life, one of the funnest videos ever. Remember, it was just all NFL touchdowns.
That is literally where Dire Straits lost me, was in the 80s. Like, the I Want My MTV. That's where I checked out. But... Dire Straits 70s music?
Phenomenal.
Early 80s.
One of the most underrated guitar players in music.
I think very underrated all the time. Is this it? Oh, yeah, here you go. Turn this up. Too much playing at once.
Yeah. He looks like a shitty tennis coach.
Oh yeah, he's so goofy looking.
He really does.
He
look
wore
like...
a sweatband like LeBron James,
way before it was supposed to be cool.
Yeah, is this it? We play now. That's always so impressive to me when it's like they're doing other shit at the same time while his fingers moving that fast.
It's just effortless.
Christine, does the girl fuck this guy for the pure talent and songwriting alone?
I think so.
You do?
Yeah.
You think you'd go for it?
Yeah, 100%.
Without a doubt, huh? Even balding like that, the whole deal.
Hey, he's so talented. It would be amazing to watch him do his thing.
What, like finger you?
You get after that. You can get over that mortgage salesman face.
100%, I could get over that mortgage salesman face.
I graduated from the tennis racket to the guitar eventually, mm-hmm. and played all through like middle school, elementary school, high school, whatever. And then I got to college and I was like, I'm going to win so much puss by playing guitar. I took guitar one and the teacher, first day, tried to teach us Sultan's a Swing. I packed
first day.
Jay, I packed my guitar and walked out of class and
of
just
course.
Quit. I was like, my hands will never do that. Like, I was just like, I'm done. There's no fucking way. First day.
Now, your homework today. You guys familiar with Jimi Hendrix? Your homework today.
Seriously. It's like, you guys, Hotel California for extra credit.
He's one of those guys, Mark Knopfler, the lead singer of Dire Straits. I hate to use such a hackneyed term, but he makes the guitar talk.
Uh-huh.
It's like him saying words. It's pretty amazing.
Yeah, he is. He's.
But yeah, I'll give you a little list, Lou, if you want to just like peruse some songs, perhaps of a Dire Straits.
Yeah.
Really good band and nice long songs, but not jammy long in that way. It's like it's very focused.
Yeah, that's my shoveling music actually. When I go out to shovel my driveway, if I ever have to, I put on Dire Straits' Greatest Hits, start to finish. And I shovel my driveway
and
down
today,
to the waterline, Tunnel of Love.
And today, what I would go. Oh.
Love struck Romeo. Coming to people.
His voice is so goofy, but it works.
Low. Juliet said, "Hey, it's Romeo. You nearly gave me a heart attack." Nah, my boyfriend's bad.
Hey, love. You shouldn't come around here staring up at people like that.
Anywho, what you gonna do about it?
This was me and my high school girlfriend's song.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Then you hit her one day. I'm not sure why I made that up.
Thanks, Jay.
I don't know, man. I just teed off and hit her one day.
Hashtag me too.
When we made love, you used to hit me.
Is this first ballot for Dire Straits? Because, I mean, this is a...
You nearly gave me a heart attack.
I'd be blown away if they didn't get it on first shot. And I would correlate them now, I say very much, to the War on Drugs.
That's a
very
great...
similar thing. Lead singer is the lead guitarist.
Yep.
Very ambient.
Mm-hmm.
Full music.
Good word. And I know that for a long time people were saying, where the fuck is Dire Straits in this conversation? A lot of years people were like, how have they not gotten in yet?
I assume they would have been a first ballot.
But what took so long?
Fucking
Green Day. Green Day gets in, and then these guys.
They've been eligible since 2003.
Wow. Just the time was wrong.
Julia. You gotta remember, though, every year they also have to, like, eke in, like, a, you know, like a... Like,
scream.
Honking Joe McGillicuddy.
Yanking Hank Williams. they gotta throw in their two fucking token pioneers.
Sloppy Bob Robertson.
Slide.
Oh, Jimmy. You didn't see Sloppy Bob play the slide whistle.
Boop. Ski.
Hey, yo. It's me, Sloppy Bob. I'm gonna get that girl. Find me a woman, take her home. Is this a fact? Alan in Arizona has a fun music fact that I'm unaware of. I looked this up.
That's my kind of facts.
Hey, what's up, guys? This is Trucker Out. I've been calling you guys since the girl from Jersey was putting the moves on you a couple years ago.
Remember her?
How's the road today?
Yeah, hey, anyways, the song Money for Nothing, real quick, was written about Bon Jovi, the little faggot with the makeup and the earring and all that. He's a millionaire.
Is it
That's about Bon Jovi when he started in the 80s. Or
Look that up, Christine.
Wow, really?
And then, and Sting was in the studio. They kept seeing him or something, and Mark Knopfler's like, hey, go get him. And they're like, hey, you want to do an intro? And he did the intro in the middle parts of that.
Would you like to play on the song?
Oh, yeah, Sting's the I Want My MTV, right?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, in that, that's about Bon Jovi, seriously. But the thing, the point being, what I was going to mention is my brother's, the brothers in arms and all that, we used to all go to the lake on the boat. And one night we were out, we used to put a lantern on shore, which is dangerous because you could dry dock the boat. But we would go out, my brother's two pit bulls swam out like a quarter mile to the fucking boat. I could not, it was freaked us. We were all drunk on whiskey, you know what I mean? And his two pit bulls, we heard them in the water. We're like, what the fuck is it? It was his two dogs. That part I do remember. That was the brothers in arms trip.
Here's my entire straight story. We got attacked by water dogs.
These dogs are cool as hell. They're good pit bulls, but they would go out and get. Literally, a choya cactus would stick them where they look like a crab. Their ass stuck to their chest sideways, and they'd be running like a crab. And, you know, pull them apart, and they go right back chasing shit. You know, it was amazing.
Wow.
That's awesome. Mike, you're a dog guy.
Yeah.
Makes sense of all that.
This call was brought to you by Ritalin.
Trucker
Crank.
Alan, thanks for the call. I'm going to look that up about the Bon Jovi thing. Christine, did you find it?
I'm not finding that. Written down looking for it.
I mean, it does make sense.
Sure.
I mean, can you see being in a, like, we're in a business where people hit quick, some people hit quick, do you have less respect for, some people hit quick, do you have massive respect, all the different things happen, but in that, can't you see writing like a passive aggressive?
Yeah,
like,
look at comedy.
I'm saying,
absolutely.
In comedy, you're almost, exactly, so, you know, you see, I can see a Mark Knopfler, who's a guy who certainly wasn't blessed with Bon Jovi hair, body, or anything else.
Right.
Or face.
Yeah.
Being like, that little guy, he looks like a lady.
Yeah.
I don't care. He's a girl. He's girly.
I could imagine it was something that they were probably playing with the riff in the studio, and he's just like, that little faggot. Like, it probably came on, like, MTV or something, and he got mad.
Bon Jovi's a faggot. He goes, you can't be that on the nose, Knopfler. He goes, sorry. Just how about that little faggot? He goes, better.
He's just mad he couldn't name his band Knopfler. He doesn't have a cool enough last name.
Bon Knopfler.
They did, in a big performance of in 1985, he changed it to Queenie.
Yeah.
From Faggot.
I remember that.
Yeah, that's what I'm finding most on this song.
I think, what year was that?
1985.
Oh, yeah, that was the height of AIDS.
Yeah.
That's when AIDS came in big.
That little Queenie's got some AIDS in his butt.
And it wasn't done, out of respect, by the way. It was done because he was worried if he calls them faggots, they were going to give him AIDS. Just so you know, Knopfler, the gays are out there, and they're looking to give you AIDS.
if you say their fucking name, you get it. Did you, he recently...
How about us a Queenie?
He recently toured with Bob Dylan and sang the shit that he can't anymore.
Really?
Yeah.
Eh. I wouldn't want to see that. Bob Dylan bores me too much. But
I mean, he does kind of sound like him.
Sure, but I would love to see the Dire Straits, and that's why I really should. Well, I mean, I have HBO. It'll be on HBO.
Yeah, I mean, really. And is it going to be Well, that's true. Right. Yeah.
Dude, I would see the Dire Straits tomorrow, but they do not perform together anymore.
Why are you calling them the Dire Straits?
The Dire Straits. I would see them. I don't know.
I want to see
the Bon Jovi.
I want to see the Nina Simone Experience.
The Nina Simone, the Screaming Jay Hawkins.
I would love to see Dire Straits.
He performs solo a bunch, but not really out here anymore on the East Coast too much. And I have a real feeling you're going to get, maybe, if you're lucky, one song you know in life.
Dude, you know what that's like?
He's going to do all new Knopfler.
We went to Jethro Tull at Meadows in Hartford, this like outdoor amphitheater, and everyone's like, you know, just pounding fucking cheap beers, smoking joints, getting ready to go to the show. We're on the lawn. He does like Bungle in the Jungle, and then he's like, I'm going to play you some parts from Rachmaninoff in A minor, and he just did flute shit.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And you just hear people like, just like in the distance, you hear like, Aqualung! They're just yelling, like, think it's a break! Like, nobody wants to fucking hear you play
Aqualung!
It sucked. It was fucking terrible. People were like, just like funneling out of the show.
Yeah, Ian Anderson seems like a jerk off that would do something like that.
But I mean, Knopfler would probably do a bunch of jazz. Like, he's constantly playing jazz. Like, that's his thing.
Is it?
He's a jazz guitar player.
Yeah. Is that what it is? So you think, I mean, that's what the beauty of this concert is, you'd see Dire Straits play together.
Doing Dire Straits songs.
Doing Dire Straits songs, which would be absolutely, absolutely amazing. Yeah, man, I'm such a fan of them.
Yeah, they're amazing. They really are.
Growing up in Jersey, Lou, Dire Straits had to do something for you, yeah?
Yeah,
were you more of a Bon Jovi guy?
I was more of a Bon Jovi guy, but the Dire Straits were cool.
I know Lou's a Bon Jovi guy because he tried to throw a monkey wrench in the work. He goes, you know this song, Bed of Roses?
Yeah.
It was one of their lesser known albums.
Yeah, he had that up his sleeve.
No. I wanted you to make fun of it, but you weren't taking my bait.
Well, it's
I just sang it.
It's a singable song. Yeah.
I'm just trying to build some drywalled extra stuff on this house.
I built everything.
Everything.
Square ridge from crown to chair rail.
That is when Jovi got a little fucking hand jobby, like tanning salon fucking songs at that point.
That's when I was out.
What would your sell be to you meet a chick and you're hoping to go on a date with her, take her on a date by listing all of your carpentry skills? Seems a very weird thing to do, man.
I was telling Black Lou before the show, there are girls in my white trash neighborhood that would love this fucking guy and think he was the, a good catch. Like, knows how to treat a woman right.
I mean, Jay, that's my family.
These are girls who have completely given up on finding their dream beau and been like, oh, he's got a fuck. His Ford Explorer's paid off.
I've been burnt too many times. At least Vinny pays his bills.
He's got a crucifix hanging from the rearview mirror. I mean, how bad could he be?
Friday night's pizza night. We move forward.
Yeah, we go play softball.
This is the type of guy you're getting.
Boop,
I'm
bing,
a very handy guy.
Bat, bing, boop.
This is my family. That's how I grew up with these guys.
Oh, it's the construction jam.
You are so beautiful.
This is my shit.
You are to me.
Oh. Oh, it wasn't full throttle yet.
Oh, look at these fuckers.
Yeah. Oh, break it down.
I feel like a woman.
Man, Jersey muscle heads really look like fucking centaurs. They really are.
Yeah, they really do.
They're built like Baby Groot.
It's just such a juice, like juice frame.
Why do you want to dance like that?
Like like a Russian hat dance.
Yeah, really. What's the matter, you? Hey, what do you gotta say? Who? Don't you love the taste? What's your mama gonna say?
No,
eat Chino's pizza rolls.
Give me a cheese with nothing.
Nothing?
Remember that commercial?
Indeed. Dan St. Germain just walked outside. You want to grab him, Black Lou?
Yep.
Tell him to come in.
The Cars is another band that made it in. And
well, I want to wait for the.
You want to talk to them about it?
Absolutely. Well, I was bringing.
I'm excited to hear. That's such a. That's when we lived together too.
There is.
Yeah.
Walking the other way.
What a dildo.
Mamlo.
He just checked out.
Yeah, he's like, fuck these guys. Listen to the music they're playing.
Over. It's over.
I'm not coming in there.
Hoo-ah.
No.
You son of a bitch.
Ciao, baby.
Dan
St. Germain is going to be joining us here in just a minute.
What's your thoughts about there being a hip-hop Hall of Fame and a Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, or should it be one in the same?
I think it could all be one in the same, for sure.
Yeah?
Absolutely. It could all be one in the same. It's funny when people come out and get mad about that, though.
I'm not mad about it. I'm just wondering if, like, you know...
It's all born from the same thing. Here's the thing. Ultimately, there will be... It's the problem with things the way they go. There could also be a hip-hop Hall of Fame. But they'll do a hip-hop Hall of Fame and still have rap in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. But there'll be no rock in the Rap Hall of Fame.
Yeah,
you know what I'm
exactly,
saying? It's like so
yeah.
weird, but like, you know, it is what it is. Listen, the people that got in so far, like hip-hop and the Hall of Fame, like, abso-fucking-lutely.
I couldn't agree more.
NWA, definitely.
I just wonder if it'll ever do the like hip-hop that deserves it the justice. And, you know, it's in Cleveland. The heart of rock and roll's in Cleveland. The heart of hip-hop's not.
I mean, Jesus Christ. And Cleveland?
Yeah.
You tell it to Bone Thugs and Harmony, motherfucker.
That's when rap got bad.
And I'm going to miss everybody. What, Cleveland? No,
Bone Thugs. No,
come
I fucking
on.
Hate Bone Thugs.
You don't mean that. It's Bone and Biggie, Biggie. It's Bone and Biggie, Biggie. Everybody, he's going to be recording his new album live. Huh?
Sorry.
Live at The Stand in New York City next Wednesday, December 27th. Get tickets at thestandnyc.com. It's DSG. Dan St. Germain joins us.
Whoa. Good to be here.
See you at the crossroads. We're talking Hall of Fame.
You're good, man.
Oh, thank you, brother.
Christine, you have new hair. It looks great.
Thanks, Dan.
You have the same hair, Mike, or else I'd, you know.
No, it's fine, and yours looks wonderful, too.
Thank you.
The beard is nice.
Thank you guys for having me.
Oh, thanks for coming in, buddy. This is, we're breaking down the inductees now into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame this year.
Who were they? You guys already have gone through this.
Well, no, we're only in the middle of it. We've gone through already
Moody
Sister
Blues.
Rosetta Tharpe, who is exactly the same kind of terrifying witchcraft music you thought it was going to be. Yertle the Turtle, known as Nina Simone.
Oh, yeah, of course.
what a nickel face.
Yertle the Turtle.
Oh, yep. I guess I'll sing a song if y'all want it. Yep.
The Moody Blues we went through already, which Mike is down on.
No, you no for the Moody Blues?
Stink bag.
But yes for... what else have we got? I don't want to...
Well, and where we're at now, we've done Bon Jovi.
Oh, come on.
No one's against that.
They're great.
I'm not really a Bon Jovi guy.
Oh, you're a Jersey guy, too,
yeah, because I'm a Bruce guy, so I always felt like Bon Jovi is like a...
But how old are you?
Poor man's... I'm 33.
It never struck you at all? Well, you know what?
Yeah,
I can see that. If they didn't catch you young...
Yeah.
It's not going to catch... You wouldn't be caught by there, like, It's My Life wouldn't be the song
like
to catch you. But Bruce's catalog... The music's a little more timeless than,
yes,
like, you know,
absolutely.
Lay Your Hands on Me.
Like, my young band, my first, like, young, good-looking guy band was Bush.
That was your first?
That was, like, the first one.
And that's way past Bon Jovi.
Way past Bon Jovi.
Yeah. We were talking, like, the actual... When Jovi was the band that we needed them to be, they fucking nailed it.
Which was what? That was, like, late 80s?
Yeah. 87, 88,
89.
Right.
They had a lot of great songs. That was my first concert. And, yeah, they were great.
They got in. All you needed at that point to keep longevity was you needed a couple years under the mark that Guns N' Roses came in. Guns N' Roses came in and just swept all that away.
Yep.
Like, they got rid of, they were like,
yeah,
if you're wearing, like, skin tight pants and, like, you know, like neon green shit and having your hair all teased up like you're a jerk off. So, like,
I get out of here.
Flannel and jeans or leather pants and fucking go be grungy rock and roll and, like, it got rid of all that shit.
I heard that Bon Jovi now is like the Democratic Party kingmaker for New Jersey. Like, you've got to, like, get his blessing to run for the state.
Oh, yeah, he owns so much. He, like, owns part of, like, arena football teams and shit. John Bon Jovi.
What kind of rich decision is an arena football team?
Well, but he can't get a rest area named after him yet. That's the problem.
He's got hair now, like a girl named Carol who works at the local library.
I haven't seen his new hair.
Oh, he's got Mary.
Can we see Bon Jovi's new hair?
He's got Mary Beth head.
Been with the same woman since high school.
Yeah, I'm sure he hasn't strayed at all.
Yeah, really, he's got...
Hey, it's Carol from H&R.
Yeah, that's how you make marriage work. You just get used to cheating.
That's it.
I think if you're dating Bon Jovi, there's got to be a point where I'm like, yeah.
Yeah, but here's the thing. Also, at the same time, you hang in there through that, and
look really fucking good.
Yeah, I don't want to point out or point fingers or make any accusations, especially so out of school on it. But if that is the case, the amount he cheats now is probably slim, like little to none.
Yeah, get
at
it
all.
Out of your system.
Yeah.
For
yeah.
years,
right?
It's probably not. I mean, it's not cheating if it's an open relationship, right? So. Yeah.
Maybe it's open. Who knows? I mean, I'm sure they have some sort of an
arrangement. I mean, it's New Jersey. How open?
There's, like, lists of the best-kept, like, Hollywood open relationships. At a point, you just kind of got to be like,
Hey, if it happens at an after-hours.
Whatever.
If it happens at an after-hours, it ain't cheating, right?
You enjoy some crown bowl level of
some drywall. You enjoying your Lamborghini, baby? Then shut your fucking mouth.
I think it's really easy if you're, like, the same level of hot, right? Like, Ryan Reynolds and Blake Lively can just hook up with whoever they want because they both are.
Yeah.
They can both go up. But I think, like, it never works out for the dude. Like, the guy in the open relationship, it's never like, no, don't worry. My chick's cool with this. Like, that's never a hot... that's never a hot thing to hear.
Yeah, girls would rather, like, feel like they're in on it with the guy than, like, the couple is okayed it.
Yeah, they want to ruin something.
They don't want to be like, oh, you and your girlfriend are a team, and I'm over here on the side. Like, they want to be the team for the night.
Right, exactly. Or they don't want, like, yeah, she's cool with me hooking up. Ugh, yeah.
Bon Jovi falls into that category of just, like, a rock star that now looks like an ugly aunt.
Yeah.
Like, they all do. Petty, when he died, he looked like like my Aunt Sue.
I mean, how old's Bon Jovi?
Timeless. 60? Would you say 60? Late 50s?
Yeah, 55.
I'd say 55.
Wow. He might be older. Yeah, he could be older.
You think he lies about his age? Maybe. Axl Rose is 55? Jesus Christ.
I see Steven Tyler.
Steven Tyler's almost 70. I
mean, he looks great, though.
He looks like every bit of that 70.
No, but he looks. I think he looks like exactly how he's looked, though, forever.
That's true.
Tom Petty, too.
He looks like Johnny Depp playing a pirate.
He really does. I watched last night about an hour of a movie I saw a bunch when I was younger called Private Resort.
I've never heard of that.
Johnny Depp and Rob Morrow. Hector Elizondo.
I remember it. It did show brief nudity.
It's a tit movie, yeah.
What a fucking...
Oh, no. Lot of nudity. Lot of nudity.
That was such a kid got caught watching it answer. It was only brief nudity.
Excessive nudity. But you know why I loved it?
The worst Cinemax After Dark show. Brief nudity.
Why I loved it so much when I was younger is because Dice. Dice is in it.
Oh, yeah?
And he's all Dice. He does every bit like the character.
He's just doing Dice.
Sort, yeah. I mean, like a not leather jacket version of it, but just like a ball-busting like Dice character.
Is this a... It's a comedy, then.
Yeah, but again, it lets you realize how much Johnny Depp is full of shit now. Like, this manufactured personality that he has is completely, it's fabricated.
Just like Hunter Thompson.
Just like, I don't know. I mean, like, when you talk to a person about the heart, are they really supposed to give you an insight into their soul? I don't know if that's like, and he's like, dude, we're going to get total boobage tonight if we go out and play a car. By the way, at one point in this movie, he suggests drugging a girl with Quaaludes to make him fuck several times.
Oh, nice.
No problem. Like, here, give her one of these. That'll make her want you. It's just no issue.
Whoa.
I was really surprised by this.
Private Resort.
But you know what was in it? Full nude and so fucking, when you were young and you had that weird reaction to, like, someone who seemed older than you, like momish but naked, was Leslie Easterbrook's in this one, who was,
Who was that again?
She was Rhonda on... Laverne and Shirley. She was the girl cop, the militant girl cop with the huge tits in Police Academy.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, I remember.
She was most recently in, or not most recently, but she was in Devil's Rejects as Mama Firefly.
Full nude?
That's Mama Firefly?
No, in Devil's Rejects. My God, she had those big, huge fucking 80s
like Mama.
Nips.
Yeah, 80s nips, man.
Those banana
so
tits.
So different than now.
Banana tits.
Yeah, banana tits and big dinner plate nips, dude. It was the best. But the one scene with her and Johnny Depp, she's just wearing like a completely sheer, see-through like robe, and it's like,
who's the guy who's right next to her? He's like wearing banana hammock.
Oh, yeah. Look
banana
at that.
Banana tits meets banana hammock. The grossest Freddy versus Jason.
Was this an early jerk flick for you, Jay?
I may have caught it the first time. Where it wouldn't have been enough to jerk, but it would have been a good, like, late night, like, ooh, look at
time
me
to jerk
scene. Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe time to jerk, yeah. But Rob Morrow and from Northern Exposure.
Hilarious.
Who smiles like a shithead after every line he says. I mean, a real shit-eating grin. He's like, can I take you after dinner tonight?
Like, like a black hole sun smile.
I'm not even semi-exaggerating this. I'll see if we can find some of his cheese stick smiles.
He's kind of doing it right now.
Let's take real quick. Brent from Virginia says he has more details on Money for Nothing by Dire Straits that he is claiming that Little Faggot is a Millionaire is about John Bon Jovi. Brent, you have more info on this?
Hey, crackle, crackle, guys.
Crackle, crackle, dude.
Actually, it might have been about Bon Jovi. I'm not discrediting that guy. But the lyrics actually came about because Mark Knopfler got a department store delivery and in New York. And so these just New York meatheads were essentially just MTV was on, and they were like, oh, look at that little, yeah. So basically those lyrics,
we're talking
just wrote
about
them down in the background.
Are people making fun of him, he's saying?
No, not making fun of him, but whatever was on MTV. Mark Knopfler was in the room while these guys were delivering a fucking sofa or something, and so he just decided to write down whatever they were saying because he found it funny that he was also in the rock business, and this is how people actually talk.
Oh, so I guess they didn't know that he was a rock star. And they were just shitting on Jersey Mama Chuchones came in.
That story sounds to me like a perfectly fabricated Mark Knopfler story just in case he gets asked why he said faggot on a song. That just sounds like such a bullshit fucking... You're probably right, but it probably is such...
Here it is. He wrote it down. He goes, a lot of the language was what the real guy actually used when I heard him because it was more real. He says the lead character in Money for Nothing is a guy who works in the hardware department in a television custom kitchen refrigerator microwave appliance store. He's singing the song. I wrote the song when I was actually in the store. I borrowed a bit of paper and started to write the song down in the store. I wanted to use a lot of the language that the guy used. That's
great. Pretty neat.
Oh, yeah. He does seem like he's covering it.
Doesn't it sound like a cover-up?
Yeah. He dedicates it to GLAAD, his ward, his all for him.
He's like, guys, I'm gonna drop F5 N-bombs in here, but I'm just speaking in the language of the people, man. Yeah. Language of the people.
I totally believe that Knopfler said this, but I don't believe it to be true. I think that it probably is about Jovi or Duran Duran or some like fucking shot to the fucking top.
And you were like, hey man, that's a little public. And they were like, dial it back a little bit.
Yeah, meanwhile, he's learning the pentatonic scale. Like, it fucking matters.
Rock musicians don't go after each other anymore, do they?
Who?
I mean, rappers do, but no, rock musicians don't.
Rappers make up for all of it. You know, it only took a couple of rap deaths before rockers were like, you know what? Let's just do a Moscow Music Peace Tour again.
That's it. Let's do another Christmas song together.
Yeah, then all of a sudden, yeah, Chuck Berry's going to do Cheeky with Bono.
Let's take our last break of the year, everybody, on live shows. We're hanging out with Dan St. Germain. He's recording his album live at The Stand in New York City next Wednesday, December 27th. Get tickets at thestandnyc.com. Mike Fenoy's album, Live from Burlington, available on iTunes. He'll also be opening for the Impractical Jokers at Nassau Coliseum New Year's Eve. Is that sold out already, Mike? I mean, it's got to be close.
It's getting close. Tickets are still available on Ticketmaster.
Awesome. Get some tickets. Our Danny Soder, of course, going to be at the Albany Funny Bone Thursday, December 28th through Saturday, December 30th. Then at the San Fran Punchline Thursday, January 4th. Through Saturday, January 6th. Get tickets at DanSoder.com. And if you need to see me, I'll be at the Hartford Funny Bone, possibly with Mike Fenoya, in Connecticut, Thursday, January 4th through Saturday, January 6th. Get tickets at BigJComedy.com. We'll be right back. It's The Bonfire.
New Jersey.
And now, back to The Bonfire with Big J Oakerson and Dan Soder.
Hello. Hello, everyone. For the last time in the calendar year 2017. Hello. It's Hello. Live. Bonfire, Comedy Central Radio, Sirius XM 95. Big J. Oakerson, Dan Soder, out doing his billions films. And joining us instead, Mike Fenoya, filling in.
Yeah.
Kicking it hard. Also joining us in the studio, the hilarious Dan St. Germain. His album recording happening live at The Stand, New York City. Next Wednesday, December 27th, get your tickets at thestandnyc.com. That was the car as we came into there.
Hello.
I told him to ride the whole song out.
Yeah.
All these bands, I'm very excited that this year's like class of inductees because it's all people I've never seen perform live before. I really thought it was going to be at the Barclays Center. I was just like, I'm going to go.
You thought every year
it
was.
It seems like a more stacked lineup than the last couple of years.
It's pretty stacked.
Oh, watch out. He's a big Pearl Jam guy.
Was it Pearl Jam last year?
Last year.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but it was Pearl Jam, but it wasn't stacked. It was like Pearl Jam, Tupac.
Yeah, that's a pretty good start.
Biting Ronnie Williams on the on the alto harmonica.
Oh, stomping Wally Clem.
Stomping Wally Clem.
Yeah, the last person inducted is always the sad. It's always like Dark Side, the best Pink Floyd cover band.
Uma Guma. You had an interesting run-in with one Rick Ocasek.
I did, yeah. It was great, actually. I saw him. It is funny how much I overthought if this was actually him or not. I mean, there's only one person that looks like that. Like a human skeleton like that?
Yeah.
Like, he's so odd-looking. And also, being every odd-looking guy, including myself in this, the bastion of hope.
You kept going.
Because, I mean, the guy fucking pulled Paulina.
Yeah.
At her hottest, and then kept her the whole time. Still together.
I wonder if his dick is that long and lanky and stupid looking like him.
I don't know, but man, she was fucking gorgeous.
Oh my God, she's unreal. But, you know, guys like that, it's just like, you know, tall, skinny guys, man, they can be ugly as shit.
Yeah.
And like ladies love it. I don't know what it is.
Us short, stocky, beautiful men have it hard.
It's confidence.
They do.
The story that, this is when I, and you know what, man, the thing that bugged me so much about your story about meeting him is, out of this 10 million times you and I went outside when we lived together, mm-hmm. this was like the one time that I wasn't out there.
Yeah, I went outside and he walked into, there's a robot store mm-hmm. next to our house, and he went in there and I was like, I'm going to wait till this guy comes out and see if it's Rick Ocasek. And he came out and I go, excuse me, I go, I'm sorry, but I go, you're Rick Ocasek, yeah? And he's like, yeah, absolutely. I go, oh man, big fan, big, big fan. And I shook his hand and then he just sort of stood there with like a, what are we going to talk about now? And I was like, I didn't really go much further in my head than this.
So,
I thought I was holding you up by doing this, but he seemed like he was so cool and ready to talk, but I just buckled.
He's like, want
to
go get a turkey club or something?
I was like, okay, so have a good day. Like, almost blowing him off. Like, all right, so that's about that, huh? Rick Ocasek, maybe you walk off now.
He turned into a bee and flew away.
It's weird. There's some people like, and this is like a much lower, this is not as cool because it's wrestling, but I went to go see Bruce Pritchard, who Dan's friends with. I went to go see his live podcast, and then like backstage, I went to say hi to him, and then I know Sean Waltman is there at 123 Kid X-Pac. But then, like, I'm just sitting there, and they're like, all right, I'm going to head out. They're like, you're leaving? And I'm like, well, yeah, man, I don't know, like, how to keep this conversation going.
Yeah, like, what now?
What now? And it's also like, I'm not going to party. We're not going to party. So it's...
Yeah, so what am I saying? So, Paulina, that's got to be fun to dip it in, huh?
So you're into Tinker Toys.
Okay, so you're into making your own robot.
Wow, she still looks great.
Oh,
she's
yeah.
still stunning. Like, he's stunning. So cool looking, and she's still stunning.
He looks like a cool wet cigar. Looking?
Yeah, I mean, I you saw that guy walking around, you'd be like, oh, that guy's cool.
He's got dark, dyed black hair and sunglasses.
I guess you get, no, but what she's saying, and I get it, it's got, he's never felt insecure a day in his life. And chicks read on that, man. That's what you're saying about the like, skinny, ugly dude, just kind of like, fuck it, man. Like,
who gives a shit? Tall, skinny guys? Doesn't matter how they look.
So the guy smells his armpits in public, goes, ooh, that's me right there. Anyway, you want to meet up later? I'm going to go hop in the shower.
So doesn't care.
Well, he looks the same, too.
Yes, he does.
Because he was creepy looking then, and he's creepy looking now.
But you get to go it, dude. The sun went down. You kept it.
His head looks like your toe when you're in the tub too long as a kid. It's a wrinkly raisin head.
He looks like a prune toe.
Prune toe.
He's
face.
Like he's the photo Stern pulls up when he wants to feel fuckable.
Yeah. Oh, hang on, Lou. Crank it up.
Look at this sweater.
Come on, everyone in America right now. But you kept it going till the sun went down. You kept it going.
My favorite Cars song is Let the Good Times Roll, and there's a fun video of them playing it at one of those, like, old gray whistle test or whatever those fucking shows were back in the, you know?
Yeah, you know, 70s? You know, there's a fun fact about the Cars. Another guy sang some of the songs. They have the same exact fucking voice.
Really?
That song, Who's Gonna Drive You Home Tonight? Oh, it's not Rick Ocasek.
Wow. Really?
I thought that was even the Cars.
Yeah, but you can go, you can watch on a video of that. It's not him singing. He just plays, like,
Was he play bass?
I don't know. I have no fucking idea.
I mean, if you can't play anything, just throw a bass on
somebody. He looks like an organ. Corner. He looks like an organ player.
Yeah, there is that kind of like arbitrary organ that no one plays. On
he looks like he's waiting for an organ donation.
Yeah. He's the Transylvanian house musician.
I dabble in pipe organ and other assorted evil instruments.
He just dips his fingers in virgin blood before a solo.
This guy, he's saying just what I needed.
Is he dead or is he alive?
Dead, 2000.
Yeah. They use the most dead guy photo.
Wow, dude. Another Ohio band.
He did Let's Go. He did Let's Go also.
Wow.
I like the nightlife, baby.
Great song.
She said
he was the guitar player.
Yeah? Who?
This guy?
Is he what he is, ultimately?
Singer, bassist, and co-founder of the
Bassist, Cars. Wow. So Ocasek played nothing.
I think Ocasek was a hire, too, by the way.
I think he's like a hobbit.
No, I think he was like a hire. I think he came in to the band.
They were looking for a Ocasek fucking...
I don't know if he was like an original member.
They're like, we're looking for a withered, tall drink of water to stand in front.
It's a shame, like, those bands that, like, they just had to change one thing and it puts them over. And then that person always gets like, this has a lot to do with me.
Absolutely.
I mean, that's what happened ultimately with Peter Cetera. Once the fucking other guy blew his brains out by accident, like a moron.
Yep.
Terry Kath. He blows his brains out by... And then Peter Cetera comes in. They start getting all those hits with his fucking crazy Peter Cetera voice.
Yeah.
And then he was like, yeah, this is really more about me. He goes, I like seeing Peter Cetera on the cover of that album, and not so much you shitheads. Not so much a fucking crusty horn section from fucking Chicago.
You just got to play their shitty old songs that you didn't write when you play in concert. That's always got to be weird.
Yeah, he has to go back. Well, so wait, is he... He is a founding member of the Cars. All right. But, I mean, how about, like, Iron Maiden? Like, Iron Maiden, like, their album Killers, that people reference that album a lot. It's like, that was their first thing. That's the most iconic cover with Eddie holding, like, the hatchet.
And Union Jack in the back, right?
No. That's the Trooper.
Oh, okay.
That's Killers, just Eddie with long hair and, like, his fist like that. And just a totally different guy. Paul Di'Anno, who just, somebody came to him and was like, hey, you gotta get a singer because this guy's just like a club dude. He ain't that good. And they got fucking Bruce Dickinson.
One of the most iconic voices ever.
I mean, ever, of all time. Yeah. So same to also get blown away by the next guy, at least in Journey, like, you know, that Filipino kid's just doing a Steve Perry impression.
Right.
Which is all you could hope for, but I mean...
And he's,
like,
doing a pretty good job.
I saw them at that Rock and Roll Hall of Fame induction last year. They got inducted, Journey.
Yeah. And he's amazing, that kid.
I don't know. There's no magic to it.
Of course not. It's a Filipino kid karaokeing Journey songs.
How is that amazing? I mean,
no, his voice, I'm saying, the way he sounds like Steve Perry is unbelievable.
Your voice is unbelievable.
Thank you.
You know what the thing is, too? It's like, I think about that. When somebody dies, like, do you let the band go? Do you let the band just go? I mean,
well, where? Chicago shouldn't
have done
that.
The Doors, when Jim Morrison died, did they go around, like Ray Manzarek and those guys?
Yeah, they did it in 2000.
Yeah.
Doors 2000.
I saw that, too.
I saw them.
I'll see who they took. A guy who, when I was a kid, the reason I liked the song Firewoman, if you could bring up Firewoman by the Cult, Christine, bring the video up is what I need, though. Let the video music play. When you see the guy, I remember being a kid and into my Doors phase big time.
Yeah.
And then I saw this video for a Firewoman, and I was like, oh, this guy sounds, and even has like the Indian kind of fetish thing of Jim Morrison.
Yeah.
And then this fucker became the lead singer of the Doors when they came around in the 2000s.
Came around again.
But this guy's got such a Morrison thing about him, even the way he dances around and shit.
Yeah.
But I don't know if that comparison was made very much. And then
I was listening. Oh, I'm sorry to interrupt.
No.
But, Joan Didion said, I was listening to the White Album. So she has a whole chapter. She like hangs out with the Doors, and it just seems like one of the most. Like, it's fun to like listen to as a reader or whatever. But like
being
seems
there,
like the most insufferable. Like if you were in that band,
yeah.
Because like Jim Morrison, you guys kind of, oh, we'll see what time he shows up today,
or just not show up. And Ray Manzarek, could you imagine? You know, it's like going to see a Doors concert, and it's like, hey, Ray Manzarek is going to sing everything. He goes, we don't fucking come here to see anybody else.
Yeah,
it's such a weirdo. But it almost seems like, too, when she was describing it, like, if you're in a heavy metal band or in a fucking rap band, like, if somebody doesn't show up, you can get in, like, an angry fight and be like, what the fuck, dude? You're blown, you're fucking this whole band. But, like, with their whole, like, oh, Aldous Huxley, like, you can't be a dick in the same way.
Right.
Hey,
oh, he seems like
you're a little late. It's like, well, what is time anyway?
Yeah.
shit.
Such an.
That's part of the mystery, man.
Yeah, man. Time is what you make it.
Can you stop talking junk talk to me, please?
He seems like he would be such an obnoxious hang, too. It's like, ghost crowd, the young child's fragile eggshell mind. It's like, Jim, the kid just lost his toy. Like, it doesn't matter. It's like, he's going to be okay.
It's also age. Once you hit certain ages and you start to get older, you realize the annoyance of that. Like, when I was a kid and watched even the Doors movie or watch interviews, yeah. And you hear him say things, he's like, just talk to his friends, like, let's make a movie, like, black and white, about our lives. The Desert Eagle flies above the thing. And you're like, kind of like, oh man, this guy's
so cool.
And then later on in life, you're just like, can you imagine sitting next to that? I'm like, oh, yeah, dude, we'll make a fuck. You just go to sleep, dude.
Just shut up.
You gotta sleep just to fuck off. You can't talk to me like this the entire flight. I can't sit like this.
Pete's having a better adventure yet.
Can we get some heroin?
So he's romantic. Man, I don't know. Robbie Krieger looks like he was in a goddamn boiler fire. Jesus Christ.
Well, you know, those parents set him on fire after he molested their kids. So.
What a gross what he looks dude. Like.
By the way, Robbie Krieger is the only one still alive.
Yeah, him and the drummer. Densmore
still alive, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Robbie Krieger looks like if one of the Columbine kids grew up and just became a janitor in Columbine High School. It was a stretch, guys. But
you nailed it. Fuck it. It was worth
the ride. Like, where the fuck is this analogy going?
We'll all just stretch and ride together, man. That's what are you going to do?
Stretch and compress, man.
I just like to picture a fat Morrison, like bearded,
bathtub Morrison,
naked on the toilet. It's like,
so alone!
I hate them.
Dude, the movie, even when I go back to the movie, how much I loved, and there's still scenes I love. Also, when you find out how much he fabricated, too. To go back and, like, watch it, there's so many annoying parts. When his girl's like, did you fucking bring the girl you're fucking behind my back to Thanksgiving? Did you fucking take acid when we have to cook for 50 people? Did you do all this stuff? And he just goes, hey, come on. I'm a spy in the house of love.
She's like, I love when you sing to me.
I'll forget it. They can eat for themselves. I'm going to blow you now.
That's what happens.
I know.
He goes, come on, forget all that.
That was like Meg Ryan was the romantic lead in that.
Absolutely. Yeah.
He wouldn't sing. So she went in and blew him during. Was it Touch Me?
No, he did Soft Parade.
Strange Days.
No, it was
Soft Parade.
She blew him during Soft Parade.
In the studio,
because they couldn't fucking wrangle him.
But they had that in the movie.
But Jim would never speak.
They had
in
that
lyrics.
In the movie.
Yeah,
yeah.
They didn't show anything though. But Jim would never speak in lyrics. Like, you know, we got to go whip those horses' eyes.
Yeah, we got to whip the horses' eyes. All and the make
dialogue.
Them
yeah, all the dialogue was his lyrics. It's bullshit.
Oh, he burned the turkey too.
Yes, yeah,
mother, you burned the turkey.
Yeah, that's the thing. They said he wasn't like a sit around in a group and being annoyingly philosophical guy. They said he was a shithead.
Yeah.
And he was kind of like trying to be like, he was like a ham. He was trying to be funny all the time.
Yeah. So all those guys think they're funny.
No, I'm saying, but he's not. But they really portrayed him as a guy who's like, oh, everything's like mysterious. Like,
yeah.
Like he wakes up in the morning, he's like, I'm hungry. But not for cereal, for knowledge.
Nobody wants to do a movie about just some dude bombing the whole time.
I want to blood.
Has anybody ever tried to get into the brain of an iguana?
I want to crack that armadillo soul and ride it deep into the
ether.
When
in actuality, like at Thanksgiving, he just had like a baby carrot in front of his crotch. He's like, look, baby dick. Baby dick.
Baby dick. Baby dick. Like, Jim. He's like, ah, come on, I'm just fucking around, everybody.
I wish he lived long enough for someone like Lemmy to just beat the shit out of him. he just lived another 5 or 6 years. Like, Tony Iommi throws him in front of a bus or something.
That's how you know, though, too, that like Lemmy didn't have like a lot of really good friends who could call him on shit, where they're like, yeah, man, the fifth Nazi... sword. Like, I get one, but you can't be the Nazi.
I don't know. It's all memorabilia. It's all memorabilia.
This Touch-O-Matic machine, like, doesn't judge me.
Yeah, but then they're like, okay, well, we have plenty of German World War I memorabilia. No, just give me the Nazi shit.
Oh, that doesn't make me feel as alive.
Yeah, this movie, man.
Yeah, it's really fucking
goofy.
Handy.
I loved it when I was a kid because we would smoke weed and watch it.
It totally got me. It's what got me into the Doors. I'm okay with that. I'm happy I got into the Doors. I really love the Doors. But, man, what a... I mean, again, everything...
it was almost like it was geared towards a 12-year-old kid because I thought it was so awesome, everything. And now you're just like, what a piece of shit this guy was to everybody around
him. Yeah, really.
As you get older, you realize how young he died. And as you get older, you're like, oh, he was just a young shithead drug addict.
But 26,
he was
27.
He's obviously incredibly talented. But
I just watched the Outcast guy did. I played Hendrix.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Right.
Have you seen it?
I heard he's good, but the movie's kind of
the movie
shitty.
Absolutely fucking blows, but he does a great Hendrix. But
yeah,
it's that same
Hendrix.
Thing where it's like, hey, man, you know, it's just like a lot of yellows in this room, and it's I'd really like more purple in here. And it's like, all right, I'm fucking done with this. Like, I wouldn't want to hang out with Hendrix. It's like you want to meet these people and be like, great job, keep it up.
But you hope they probably weren't. Listen, it's the same thing we just said when we watched a clip of Johnny Depp. It's like you put on a thing that's like, especially with a comic, that's going to really irritate the shit out of you when someone's playing too cool for school. You know what I mean?
I don't know,
man. That's your journey, man. That's your journey. I'm on my journey. You're on your journey. You're like,
no, Felix, excuse me.
Hey, Daddy-O. Fucking stop talking to me like that.
I haven't, you know,
Pink Panther.
Hey, cat.
I haven't seen this as much, but I remember when I first started, there was like a couple dudes. And it seems like it's died out, but like that wannabe Hicks, wannabe Lenny Bruce, that kind of like, I'm the truth. It seems like everybody now realizes there's no money anymore.
Right, absolutely.
We're all kind of either, you're like depressed and good at it or depressed and bad at it.
Make a cartoon about an Uber instead.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think you could be good at comedy and not be I think that's just a personality trait, and I think there is a weird, like, depressive people tend to be drawn, I guess, to doing this for some reason, because it's like kind of, you know, on my most bummed out day, we still got to come be funny on the radio for 2 hours. You know what I mean? Like, that's kind of like a good thing, I guess, to have for someone who's depressive. But yeah, but overplaying like the... I wear shades every day, all day.
Yeah, it's funny, too.
I'm going to go sit in a park and stare at the lake.
Well, like that Kinnison thing's coming out, too. And, like, there's not a ton of, like, crazy drug partying going on anymore.
Nobody
in comedy
has the money. Everyone who does, like... Now it's like, people do coke, but they're like, I'm not fucking telling you if I have coke. I'm doing all my coke.
I can't afford to share it. Right? Because it's not like, there's not like a, like, you know, you don't see like comics going and like running into a bathroom and booting up together anymore. Like, it doesn't seem like even like,
no, now it's
quite
like,
a few don't even really
like
drink.
You have to do so much more to get so much less now. On the average level, I'm saying, of comedy.
Yeah.
In comedy, you have to do so much. There's
everything, dude.
I can't fucking, like, go to a party till 7 o'clock in the morning. Like, I have to wake up for something.
Right.
You know what I mean? There's something I have to do at, like, noon. So, you know, I would be like, I got to promote something on a radio show. Or I got to do it. So the idea of these, like, we were out till 7:30 in the morning, came right to radio. I'm like, this is no fucking way.
I literally just went from wearing a spring jacket outside in winter weather, and I changed my winter coat and having 2 slices of pizza, and I'm like, I'm ruined for the rest of the night. I'm ruined. I have a spot at 11. I can't do this spot.
I'm exhausted.
I need to sleep this off before it turns into typhoid.
Dan, did you find living out in L.A., is there more of that, like, drug party culture in LA than in New York amongst comics?
Well, I don't know, because whenever I do, and I'm bouncing back, honestly, from a relapse like a couple months ago, whenever I do it, it's like, I, like, go hard.
Yeah, it's like way dirtier than the party scene.
Yeah, I find all the fun.
Drugs and booze?
Yeah. So, like, when that happens, like, I'm off the reservation. Because, too, everybody else knows that I'm sober. So, like, if I ran into Dan Soder and I was, like fucking blowed out of my gourd or whatever, he'd be like, we need to get you to a hospital. There wouldn't be like, hey, let's go down the Sunset Strip and meet models, you know?
So you hide it?
I had 2.5 years sober, and then, I don't know why, but I had 2.5 years sober, and I was having panic attacks, so then I got prescribed Klonopin, and then the Klonopin just turned me into a different guy, and within like 5 days later, I'm like...
Doing what I thought was
coke, but turned out to be meth, you know, like,
yikes. How was it?
Yikes.
Was it as awesome
sucks.
As it looks?
Snorting meth.
Yeah, it sucks.
Ooh, that's got to be painful.
Well, tell the people from my new favorite documentary, Meth Storm, seem to really enjoy it. you don't like staring out your window and then looking through the woods with a buck knife for the people who are staring at you that don't exist?
Painting your window with black paint.
They are staring at them.
there's no like fun like Doors movie about meth. You know,
no.
So it's like it's Walter White.
You and a
did you invite the girl you're fucking over for Thanksgiving?
Did you steal this? Did you not show up for a concert? Yeah, it's like, oh, I got a lot of things I got to do. I got to, well, first of all, I'm working on this new business where I buy baseball cards and then I resell baseball cards. And you can make a little bit of money off that, honestly. You might honestly live off that for like probably a year if we had to live off that for a year.
Come on, baby, let me on fire.
This song, oh, yeah, come baby, let me fire. It's a good song.
It's all happening in a Denny's parking lot at the same time.
Yeah, it wouldn't even be like, why are you doing this? Shut the fuck up, bitch.
He's like, how's that song go? He's like, oh, I'll do it for you right now.
You hear it?
Oh, man, that's crazy.
But anyway, I'm good now, by the way, in case anyone was nervous.
I'm very nervous. Sam, I'm happy to know you're okay. We're all okay. I hope everyone's okay going into this new year.
Yeah, we're before we wrap, man, I love you. Happy New Year.
I love you too, buddy.
It's been such a fun year.
And to Jacob, wherever you're at, we love you too, buddy. And Hanukkah's over now, so enjoy your shitty day of Christmas. Black Lou,
yay.
White Lou,
yay.
I love you guys. It's been an amazing fucking year. Here's to unlimited amounts more. We'll keep going until they make us leave. Christine, I love you. Merry Christmas. Happy holidays to everybody. And tomorrow, again, we're going to be airing the live holiday show we did at the Village Underground. It was a great show. Lou says it was hard to even edit down because it was so fun. And we had a blast. Make sure you check out Kinesis.
That was my favorite live show we've done. I'm sorry I yelled it.
And as a ancillary to the show, as a regular, I'd like to say thanks to the fans. These fucking fans are pretty goddamn cool, man.
They're amazing. On the road, I'm getting to meet so many of them.
They're so fucking great.
And the more I go back to these towns I haven't been at since we've done the show, or since the show's picked up steam, or going 4 days a week, it's the outpouring is amazing. Dan St. Germain, thanks for hanging out with us.
Thank you. Thank you for having me,
Dan's going to be recording his album live at The Stand in New York City. That's next Wednesday, December 27th. Get tickets at The Stand, thestandnyc.com. Dan's absolutely fucking hilarious.
Thank you, buddy.
Can I add one other thing? Absolutely.
If you are not in New York, near in Madison, Wisconsin, I'll be at Comedy Club on State January 4th through 6th. I'm also going to be recording then, so please come
up. Cool. Oh, very, very cool. And Dan Soder, our friend, of course, my heart, my co-host, my partner, going to be at the Albany Funny Bone Thursday, December 28th through Saturday, December 30th. Then at the San Francisco Punchline, Thursday, January 4th through Saturday, January 6th. Get tickets for that and all Dan shows at dansoder.com. You can get Mike Fenoy's album live from Burlington on iTunes. He's also going to be opening for the Impractical Jokers at the Nassau Coliseum on New Year's Eve. It's a big show. He says some tickets are still available. Go get them. And me, I'll be at the Hartford Funny Bone in Connecticut Thursday, January 4th through Saturday, January 6th. I got Vancouver Comedy Mix coming up. New Year's Eve, I'll be in San Francisco at the Masonic Theater with Dave Attell. A lot of fun stuff coming up. Cap City Comedy Club in Austin, Texas. So a ton of stuff coming up. Please check. Always follow us at The Bonfire SXM on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. And we love you guys. Thank you for another amazing year.
Absolutely.
We'll see you in 2018.
Also, next week we are off, but Jacob put together some awesome best ofs 2017.
Oh, yeah.
So be sure to tune in next week. They're going to be, we're all excited to listen.
We love you guys. We'll catch you in 2018. Peace.
Mwah. Ciao, baby.